I was really honored when I was asked to speak today, but it was a tough decision because it's Diageo's results day. So where to be? And I've just checked the share price. Shares are up, so I don't think anybody's missing me. Good news. But why did I think it was more important to come and talk to you than to be back at home? And I guess it's because I believe that talking about, you know, this topic, business brand and personal responsibility, might just get us all thinking about what the brands we work on can do to make the world a better place. And that's kind of an audacious goal, but I think it matters a lot, and I think it matters a lot right now. Why? I think it matters because in this era of transparency, and there's been a lot of talk about that today, consumers know and care about what we and our brands do. I think it matters because our brands can contribute more than their functional benefits to society. It matters because, and this is something we've learned, starting with people's needs and a brand's higher purpose leads to great creative work, and that's incredibly important. And it matters because our brands and our businesses can do a lot to help navigate, help people navigate what is an increasingly complex, unequal, and perilous world. So I think this has become clear today throughout the conference. People are seeing 2016 as a tumultuous year like no other. Seismic shifts in the world order. We saw Brexit, then we saw Trump, Syria, Turkey. And with change and disruption comes unpredictability and uncertainty. And the public hates unpredictability just as much as the financial markets do. So, in a world where people are finding it harder and harder to know what's real, when falsehood is given equal billing with the truth, what can we as leaders do to build brands that are reliable and truthful? At Diageo, we take quite seriously the data that says, despite the billions that we spend in advertising and marketing, I can't do the math fast enough to add up what the spend of all of us who work on brands in this room would be, but it'd be a lot. It'd be, you know, a very big number. Despite all that spend, 73% of people wouldn't care if all brands disappeared. But the data also says that 92% of people would be happy to do business with a brand that shares their beliefs and values. So what does this mean for us? In a world of 24/7 social media feeds, breaking news all the time, and ad blockers, people are actively choosing what they're going to pay attention to. I mean, they are in control. We have to accept that. And we know that they want to connect with things that feel safe and trustworthy and aligned to what they care about. So, how is it possible for something as commercial as a brand to meet these deep human needs? At Diageo, we look to the past to help answer this tricky question. This is a company built by entrepreneurs, people of extraordinary passion. We always think we stand on the shoulders of these giants, and we are the custodians of their intellectual property, their ideas, their philosophy, and we benefit from their sheer audacity. So social purpose combined with common sense is in our DNA. So let's talk about one example, Arthur Guinness. Arthur Guinness signed a 9,000-year lease. No, I don't have the number wrong. 9,000-year lease, that is long-term thinking, on St. James's Gate Brewery in 1759. Now, that's 30 years, think about it, before the French Revolution. And he established St. James's Gate as the center of the community, and he cared as much about its people and whether or not they were prospering as he did brewing great beer. John Walker. John Walker was once a humble grocer, and he achieved his goal of becoming the most renowned purveyor of scotch in the land. But for his son, Alexander, that wasn't enough. He wanted to go global, and he made a deal with Glasgow's ship captains to carry John Walker to the four corners of the earth. So, Johnny Walker in 1910 was in 120 countries before Coca-Cola had even left America. So why am I telling you these stories? It's because many of us in this room work on brands that have broad global reach or deep local influence. And with that, we have powerful voices. Voices which have the ability to channel energy, disrupt social norms, and spotlight critical issues. I think brands can act as catalysts for positive social change. We have a voice, and when used well, that voice can make a difference. In places where fundamental human rights and freedoms are not respected, brands can, I think, start the right conversation. So that's my focus today. It's not our self-regulation. It's not our relationship with governments. It's not even what we do in the community, although all of those things are critically important if we want our industry to progress. But I wanted to keep my message really simple and focus on one of the most powerful things I think we can do. And that is to look at our creative work and ask, what is this saying to the world? How do I describe, you know, what I want our work to do is to reflect the possibility of a better life. I want us to ask ourselves, are we clear on the purpose, the higher purpose our brands can serve? In recent years, we have redefined all of Diageo's brands in terms of their social purpose. And it's important to see, you know, to understand we're seeing huge benefits from this because we see this as handrails, not handcuffs. You know, it's good for the community, good for our business, and good for our people. And it's had a transformational impact on our creative work. Working with AMV, for example, AMV BBDO, I'm supposed to say both words probably, on Guinness alone, we have won 21 Cannes Lions for our work since we moved the brand onto a purpose platform. And last year, we won that award that I think many of us admire, which is a gold in the IPA effectiveness work, showing that the Made of More campaign not only moves people, but it has a tremendous effect on our sales. So we've learned that having a strong brand purpose and linking that to occasion drives growth. So let's take an example, Guinness and rugby. That combination that I hope you kind of automatically associate is actually not built by chance. It is based on a shared values, deeply shared values. So Guinness's core values of power, goodness, and communion are reflected in the sport's ability to bring people together in that way that I think rugby does really, really specially. And it makes rugby a strong backdrop for Guinness to tell its stories and talk about its purpose of celebrating those people of character who make a contribution in the world by grouping together with others. And that makes for a more fulfilling life. So here's one of the stories. It's about Gareth Thomas. He was the first professional rugby player to come out as gay. And he did so. It tells the story of how the support of his team, so communion, gave him the strength, power, to be a role model, goodness.
Everything I went through out there was nothing compared to the demons inside. In my darkest hour, I turned to my teammates. Telling them I was gay, that was the toughest thing I've ever done. But when I needed them the most, they were there for me.
The results of our World Cup program were beyond our expectations. 8 million in incremental sales over a very short period of time, and we gained share over Heineken, who was the official sponsor. But the icing on the cake was that we won a canned glass lion last year for this body of work. Now, this is a new award that celebrates creativity that makes a difference in the world by highlighting injustice or inequality. So strong evidence that purpose works. Now, numbers and awards are one thing, but what really matters to me is the effect that advertising can have on real people. Now, I only have a little bit of time to show you a snippet of the interview we did with Gareth, and I think he tells the story about the impact on him and others better than I ever could. Can you roll that, please?
Rugby is a brutal sport. I wanted to be extra macho, extra strong, extra tough. People are gonna think this guy is not just tough as a player, he's tough as a person, which meant that I couldn't be anything else apart from a straight man in a man's world. On the outside, I had everything. Happily married captain of the national team, but I was living a lie. I was gay. I just felt that I wasn't being honest with who I am. Sometimes we live in a society which judges people, judges them on one word, gay, bisexual, transgender, and I didn't want to be that. I just felt like I would lose everything that I had worked so hard to make myself, my family, my country proud of me. I thought that they would all walk away. They'd all turn their back. I had to do it. When I came out to my teammates, they patted me on the back and just said, "We don't care. Why didn't you tell us before?" It was almost in a way, I was like, "Is that it? Seriously?" And they're like, "It doesn't matter." I felt this overwhelming protection given to me. Life seemed worth living again. I decided to make the film with Guinness so others who felt alone and different would have the bravery to be themselves. It broke down so many barriers. The reaction I had from the campaign was amazing. People constantly stop me in the streets, you know, saying, "Do you know what? They're actually living a life now that I never thought they could have." But the fact I can affect someone's life in a positive way is better than any trophy I've ever won.
I've seen that a dozen times, and I always have to recover a little bit after watching it. Johnny Walker's purpose is to inspire personal progress, and we communicate this purpose through stories that are often topical and relevant. So again, connecting to the panel before, we are very happy to stir the debate. So Ode to Lesbos is about the refugee crisis. People have different opinions. We believe it's a story of extraordinary acts of selflessness by people on a tiny Greek island who, in response to the crisis, saved thousands of people. This film shows how people can demonstrate that they can progress themselves and help others to progress through small acts of kindness. And again, this is the 90-second cutdown, which I hope inspires you to go online and watch the full 4 minutes.
Δεν μπορείς να φανταστείς το τι γινόταν εδώ. Τώρα τι να σου πω, δεν μπορείς να φανταστεί άνθρωπος, ανθρώπινος νους.
Αντί να ψαρεύουμε ψάρια, ψαρεύαμε ανθρώπους. Κάτι σκηνικά τρελά.
Όλα αυτά τα σωσίβια που βλέπουμε εδώ είναι κόσμος. Και ήρθαν εδώ, ήρθαν για να βρουν ένα μέρος να ζήσουν.
Όχι μόνο εμείς, και το χωριό βοήθησε και οι ψαράδες βοηθήσαν.
Τι ευχαριστιώσαι άμα κάνεις κάτι ένα καλό, σύνδεται την τελεπορημένη ανθρώπη. Ευχαριστιώσαι.
Να βλέψεις αυτό το που γίνεται και να πεις, εμένα δεν με ενδιαφέρει. Δεν είναι έτσι τα πράγματα όμως.
Για αυτούς τους ανθρώπους που σώσαμε είμαστε ήρωες, για αυτούς. Αλλά προσωπικά εγώ δεν νιώθω ήρωας, γιατί. Τι ήρωας. Αυτό που έπρεπε να κάνω θα το έκανε. Οποιοσδήποτε άνθρωπος θα το έκανε.
And if you'd like to donate to Mercy Corps, who we're partnering with, I invite you to do so. Smirnoff. Smirnoff's purpose is based on studies that we've made of millennials. Now, I know millennials is a really controversial term, and I know they're not all the same, but that's the cohort we studied, and as a shortcut, that's the word I'm going to use. Now, these studies reveal many, many things, but one thing that kept coming up over and over again is that they value diversity, all kinds of diversity. And because of this, they particularly value inclusivity, and that has a fantastic fit with Smirnoff. Remember, when you're talking a brand, brand purpose, if it's not authentic, if it's not in the brand's DNA and in the brand's history, it's going to ring false with consumer. But, you know, Smirnoff has never pretentious. It has always been democratic, always been for everyone. So We're Open is a simple declaration of inclusivity. And that's all kinds of inclusivity, gender, sexuality, disability, just to name a few. So we did some insight work, and we learned that people are inspired by the cultural contribution of those who, in theory, would be the least able to make a difference. And we met a man called Chris Fonseca, who is a deaf dance teacher. So think about it. How do you teach people how to dance if you're deaf? And he inspired us to create content around his story, and here's a short form version.
There's not many teachers out there who can teach a deaf person how to hear music. Everybody be a boo, everybody be a boo. Missy y'all, missy y'all, we're dancing too. Everybody to the... We are in a canoe, stepping, stepping. Watch me now, 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 now.
Fun. Alongside normalizing disability, we want to lead in the area of gender equality. That's not just because it's important to me, it's important to Diageo, it's important to people. And we want to do that especially in the areas where it's culturally relevant. So, International Women's Day, I think, is about building a more inclusive world. And Smirnoff is a big sponsor of electronic dance music. And our cultural insight was that the female contribution to EDM was significant, but vastly overshadowed by the men who dominate this particular music scene. So, partnering with Vice, we're telling inspirational stories of female DJs who are leading the way. The program is called Disc Woman, and it supports new DJs, female DJs who are just getting their start. And we only spent £600,000 globally last Women's Day, and that's not very much for a global program, on the content that we ran. And for that, we got 283 million impressions, a particular measure that I hate, but at least it says it's a lot, and 19 million unique views on digital. So this makes Disc Woman the most effective earned media program Smirnoff has ever done. Because we talked about something people cared about. So it's not just Diageo doing this kind of work. There are many brands doing purpose work I admire. One of my favorites is the Maltesers campaign that started during the Paralympics and has continued. I remember when I first saw it on TV, and I did that rare thing of, I hit rewind going, no, that isn't a woman talking about her sex life in a 30-second ad. Yes, it was. So I've used it with my team as an example of real bravery. It's one of the few things I've seen that I go, not sure if I would have been brave enough to run that. But Mars absolutely made the right decision because they showed it as a very empowering and moving, you know, point of view on disability.
So, new boyfriend.
Right.
And we are back at his, getting a little
frisky.
Don't put frisky. My hands may have been wandering slightly.
Go on.
And then I start having a spasm.
No.
Which he misinterprets.
So awkward.
He was a good lady.
You're so bad.
That's what he said.
Yes, that was what you thought it was. More seriously, as leaders of our industry, we have the power to normalize disability, racial, and gender equality through what we choose to show in our ads. And Maltesers proves that you can be inspiring, on brand, and fun. I don't want to leave you with the impression that purpose-driven work has to be heavy. I mean, Captain Morgan, its brand purpose is to inspire people with the power of fun. And we hope we do that frequently. So, what do we know about whether or not purpose work is effective? Now, I could show you a million different studies, but you'd be bored, so I picked just one because it goes across a lot of categories, and it's one you probably are familiar with. And it's the work that Jim Stengel did with Millward Brown that showed that the top 50 brands who clearly communicated a purpose had a 400% increase in brand value over a decade over those that didn't. John Mackey of Whole Foods calls this conscious capitalism. And he believes it is imperative to our commercial success and to attracting the very best talent to our industry. And what's more important than that? Our work is only as good as our people. So millennials are a big part of our workforce, and this chart tells us, it's a little complicated, but it tells us what we already know. If the values of the company are not aligned to things they believe in, they are more likely to leave. They are very demanding. Now, it's impossible to talk about brand purpose and corporate responsibility without mentioning Unilever. Since clearly articulating their purpose in their sustainable living plan, Unilever has become the eighth most in-demand employer in the world, and they're absolutely top in FMCG. More proof that their strategy is working on a number of different levels. At a corporate level, Diageo's purpose is celebrate life every day, everywhere. And by that, we don't mean raising a glass, though I don't mind if you do. It really is meant to define how we operate as corporate citizens, how we are as teammates with each other, and it acts as a beacon for our brands. So our culture is deeply rooted in this purpose and in our values. You know, to go along with that, we have changed our measurement criteria to account for both the social and commercial impact of what we're doing. So alongside all the things we would have talked about in our results today, you know, profit, share, sales, brand equity, we measure ourselves against the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, the 12 out of the 17 that are relevant to our category. A long way of saying you have to measure what matters. So I hope that I've given you just a few things to think about today. But what I want to leave you with is this. Leading with purpose is a choice. And it's one that I believe pays reputational and financial dividends. But remember, corporations and brands don't lead, people do. And by people, I mean us. It's easy to look up and say, oh, that's the job of the executive or the board or the corporate relations department. But really, really, if we want to make a difference, it's going to take all of us. So ultimately, this comes down to how you want to lead and whether or not building a brand with purpose, building brands with purpose, matters to you personally. It's not easy. We won't always get it right. But trying each and every day to create the biggest possible difference makes what we do more meaningful, more fulfilling, and I think more fun. We are living in turbulent times with consumers who demand and reward authenticity. We as an industry have a voice in ourselves and in our brands that can make an enormous difference to people's lives. Let's make sure we use it. Thank you.